So second meeting. So in the first meeting, we had provided a brief introduction about the course in a very brief manner. But I refer you to the basic document I had provided, which is the guidelines. Now, by the way, could all of you access iTaleem?
No, sir. It's down right now.
No, sir. Down.
Not right now. Not if you access right now, but could you access before?
Yes.
No. Yes, sir.
Could you obtain the documents?
Yes, sir.
Can I ask Mr. Muhammad Aqil from Section 4? Could you open iTaleem and access the documents, Mr. Aqil? Is Mr. Aqil here? I can see 87 participants, which is almost all. About, I think, a few missing, but not many. Is Mr. Muhammad Aqil here? Even if his mic is not working, at least can you give some indication that you are here? Okay, I'll open the group view. Can someone view here if he's Mr. Aqil around? Well, Mr. Muhammad Noor Azlan from Section 1. Is he here? Yes, perhaps you may have problems, but I think this is not the only class. So you should be more familiar with the options here than me. Well, Madam Bushra from Section 1, is she here?
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Very good. So could you access iTaleem?
Yes, I can, sir.
Not right now. Before the class, you should access the document, gone through and done many things. What are the documents
you have? There are PDFs of textbooks and all that.
Well, yes, some books I have uploaded, but the main books are not there. Which I'm not sure whether soft copies are available. For instance, the book of Professor Wahab Az-Zuhaili. I have uploaded the English translation, the two volumes translated into English. They are there on iTaleem. But as I have explained in the guidelines, the volume more relevant to this course is another which has not yet been translated into English, but the Malay version is available. But I'm not sure whether it is available in soft format or not. So usually I used to give a copy of this Malay version in the beginning of the semester so that students can make copies for themselves, because that is the basic book which is relevant to this course. But unfortunately, in the beginning of last semester, I had two copies. One disappeared in one of the previous semesters, and the second copy I had disappeared, meaning it was never returned to me in the last semester. So that means, as I have mentioned somewhere in the guidelines, anyone who is present in the university can go to the library and obtain a copy, and you can share it with the colleagues. You can do so with regard to other books as well. How many of you are in the campus? Is everyone at home?
No, sir. Some of us are in the campus.
Very good. So they can go to the library and get these books, and if you wish, make copies. Maybe. And you can share with the colleagues, of course, without any copyright infringement. Well, now, who answered me just now? Madam Bushra. Yes. Could you go through the guidelines? Quick. Madam Bushra binti Muhammad Amir.
Yes, sir, I can go through the guidelines.
Not you can, but you did or not?
Oh yeah, yes. I did. Yes.
Okay, very good. You had to go through it carefully, more than once. The details about how we shall conduct the course are all there. So So if you ask any question from the guidelines later, I will merely refer you again to the guidelines, because some of the questions you will be asking about the course are already answered there. So the any question you are raising pertaining to conducting this course could most probably be due to you are not going through the guidelines. You see, if you ask any questions such as, well, how are you to conduct, let's say, the presentation? Of course, you may ask questions, but make sure you go through the document very carefully. Mr. Muhammad Al-Fitri, is he here from section 4?
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. Did you go through the guidelines?
Yes, sir.
Could you obtain the books?
Yes, iTalim.
Oh, well, not iTalim, the other books.
Well,
I'll give you time until the end of next week to obtain the necessary books, because don't try to follow this course without the necessary books. So get these, urge your colleagues in the campus to go to the library and obtain these and share. Some of them, I haven't tried whether soft copies are available or not. Some are with regard to some years, but with regard to others, I'm not very sure. You can try or ask your colleagues to obtain them and share with you. Well, Mr. Muhammad Ubaidullah from section 4, are you here?
Yes, sir.
Very good. So can you tell me, what should you do before the class? What have I said in the guidelines?
In the guidelines, wait.
No, out of your memory, what should roughly be done before the class? You can answer that from your understanding, although I had mentioned it in the guidelines. Well, you are supposed to read at least one from one textbook about the topic we are going to discuss in the class. This means that you should have a prior understanding or at least some idea about the topic we are going to discuss. Don't come to the class totally blank, because I mentioned to you that we are conducting this course on the flipped classroom basis, which is that you study on your own and the class is conducted merely as a touch-up. So prepare well beforehand, at least read one book, and then after the class you can go through the other books for additional details, especially because I have said I am not giving you any course material such as handouts or slides, and don't think that you can rely on the slides given perhaps in the other class, because they may not be entirely relevant or suitable. So make sure you study properly and take your notes in the class. Well, I asked the class rep to convey to you that before the class you should go through or listen to two of the records on iTalim. Yes. Madam Noor Amira from section 4, are you here? Yes. Quick. Madam Noor Safiya from section 4. Yes. Mr. Muhammad Ihsan from section 4. Yes. Mr. Muhammad, in fact, there are two Ihsans. Mr. Muhammad Ali and Mr. Muhammad Ihsan Mustaqim. Any one of these two here? Both are from section 4. Well, some of you may have problems with mics and all, but I don't think that all of you have problems. Madam Ayman Zahida, is she here?
Yes, sir.
I can see 95 now. How come 95? I am one, so 94. That means both classes have increased. Or you are joining your kick, ten, kin, and relations as well. Yes, 95 here. 95 students, how come? I think one in one class 42, and the other, I think perhaps two joined 48. So shouldn't be more than 90 maximum. Well, so Mr. Akmal Hadi from section one. Any indication of you're being around?
Yes, sir.
Who are you?
I'm here. Akmal Hadi.
What's your name? Very good.
Akmal Hadi.
Okay. So make sure that your colleagues are present because I'll be checking in the middle. And the class reps are supposed to take attendance in the sense that you need not mark one by one, but take note of who is absent. Take note of who is absent and let me know. Wait. Now, we started to discuss the, Madam Host, can you enable screen sharing?
Okay.
So. About contract. And we said that the term is Aqd in Islamic law. I asked you to go through two of the records on Aitali. Both of these were in the first lessons in previous semesters, a long time back. So, but that's what I could find. So if we had gone through where we had time to discuss things in more detail. So you should have a fair idea of the topic by now. So I explained that the word Aqd and the meaning of Aqd is what we refer to when we mean or as contract. Although the scope of the term Aqd is more limited than contract in the wider sense, as you shall see now and once you compare the two definitions. Well, how do you define Aqd? We said essentially in Islamic law, Aqd is referred to as the conjunction or coming together or joining together of the expressions of the contractors. When the contractors in the contract happen to be only two, they can be offer an acceptance. If not, in a contract of partnership, for instance, where there can be more than one contractor, we can merely refer to them as expressions of the contractors. So these expressions coming together in a specific manner in such a way that a legal effect is created on the subject matter concerned. So this is the meaning we conveyed through our definition, conjunction of the offer with the acceptance in a legally identified manner, establishing its legal effect on the relevant or concerned subject matter. The wording can differ because this is a translation of the original definition in Arabic. So different authors can translate this into English in different words, but you can get the idea of what is referred to in the definition of contract. So I indicated earlier that similar to any other definition, this definition too comprises clauses. And each clause has its own significance. So if you're asked to discuss definition, you are supposed to discuss the significance of each clause. What is the meaning of significance? By significance, we mean, what role does that clause play in making this definition complete so that this definition indicates the meaning of Aqd properly in the Sharia? This means that here, now we see Aqd being referred to as conjunction between the offer and acceptance. And that is the first clause. reference to conjunction between of an acceptance, and then there is reference to the legality taking place in a legally recognized or legally identified manner, another clause, and then reference to establishment of legal effect, a third clause. You think? Legal subject matter. So if you ask to discuss the definition, you should discuss if any of these clauses is missing, how will the definition become incomplete? For instance, if this definition does not refer to legality, what will be the shortcoming created in this definition? Remember, if you ask to discuss the aqd or definition of aqd, you are not supposed to discuss aqd itself. You are supposed to discuss the definition, how complete it is, how successful it is in conveying what aqd is, what a contract is in Islamic law, and what is the significance of each clause. And if one of these clauses is missing, how will that make the definition incomplete? So if, for instance, this reference to legality is missing, if the definition does not say taking place in a legally valid manner, what will be the shortcoming created in this definition? Who can tell me? If you have listened to the record, you should be able to tell me. Madam Alifa Noor Shukriya, is she here? Are you here or not? Quick. Yes. Madam, one Sara Sufia Binti, one Abdullah. Are you here? Yes, what's happening? All of you have mic problems? Well, so if the reference to legality is missing from the definition, the shortcoming created is that this definition then will start to be true about illegal contracts also. All forms of illegal contracts where conjunction between offer and acceptance takes place, but not in a legally valid manner. You see? Those contracts will also be covered by this definition. So the purpose of mentioning legality, that this conjunction ought to take place in a legally valid manner, is to confine this definition to legal contracts only. If not, for instance, two people agree between them, I'll pay you so much, I am hereby agreeing for payment of so much to you for attacking so and so, or stealing his notes, let's say before the exam. Okay. So they agree on this illegal contract. Now, should the definition cover this? It should not cover. The definition should not be true about an illegal contract, or a contract to assault someone illegally, unlawfully, or murder someone. It is a contract, but illegal contract. So this definition should not cover those contracts. Also, a contract where the requirements are not fulfilled. For instance, a minor or insane person creates a contract. This definition should not be true about such a contract. So if the definition does not contain a clause that refers to legality, what will happen? This definition will fit on to those contracts as well. So the purpose of the reference to legality here in the definition is to exclude illegal contracts. You see, if this clause is not there, then legal as well as both illegal contracts will come under the scope of this definition. So, well, in the class where we had more time, I used to explain and draw diagrams to show that the purpose of each clause in this definition or any other definition, proper definition, is to either include some component or to exclude some component. So the purpose of Reference to legality here is to exclude the illegal contracts from the scope of the definition of Aql. You see? Well, so you can in that way discuss each of these clauses. You can get material from my previous records as well as your reference works. Well, now, what does this definition refer to? We are talking about the coming together of the expressions of parties, you see, in a definitive manner, so that the legal effect is created there and then. The easiest example is that of a sale. I have hereby sold this particular item to you at such and such a price. I have hereby purchased the same item from you at the mentioned price. These two expressions comprise a contract, and this is not a mere agreement to create a legal effect in the future. Here the legal effect is created there and then, and what will the legal effect be? The ownership of this item transfers or is transferred from one party to the other. This is the legal effect created by these words, expressions made by the parties. Before that expression, before the parties made this expression, the item belonged to one. He could enjoy that item. He could draw benefit from that item. He was liable for that item. You see? And after this exchange of expressions, this results in the transfer of the ownership of that item from one party to the other. Mere exchange of these words in the proper legally identified manner results in this legal effect. So here now we are talking about this process of creating legal effects, because in short, Aqd is a process of intentional creation of legal effects of various sorts through meaningful expression. So here, based on the expression of the parties, the ownership transfers from one party to the other, so that at the end of the second expression, now the second party had become the owner. He can enjoy its fruits, and he is the person who has the right to do transactions and other things based on the details that we shall study or discuss later in transactions 2. It has details. So these legal effects are realized through these expressions. Now, before these expressions, the first party, the seller, could keep the item with him. But now, after these expressions were created, an obligation is created. Obligations are created on the parties. What is the obligation created on the first party, the seller? Who can tell me? Quick. Yes, you should have listened to my records and gone through at least one text. Yes, Mr. Muhammad Ibrahim. Is he here? Bin Zaidi?
Yes, sir.
What is the obligation created on the seller by virtue of this exchange of expressions? Let me tell you. Now he has to submit and hand over the item to its new owner. Ownership was created through these expressions, and now the seller can no longer keep it with him. Why? Ownership has transferred, and now he is obliged to hand over that item to the other party. What is the obligation created on the buyer? Who can tell me?
Not sure.
Madam Nuha binti Ayman. Yes? Who is speaking? Yes, Madam Nuha binti Ayman here.
Yes, sir.
Okay, tell me, what is the obligation created on the buyer based on your common sense? Once a contract or sale takes place, what is the obligation created on the buyer?
You have to pay the items.
On the buyer, he has to pay the agreed price. Before this exchange of expression that we call the contract, there was no such obligation. Now, this contract resulted in the creation of this obligation as well as rights, such as what? The seller can demand the price. The buyer can demand the item. So all these and other obligations and rights are created based on this exchange of legally valid expressions. And many of these legal effects are reflected on the subject matter, such as, now in this case, transfer of ownership. Ownership of what? Ownership of the subject matter, the item sold, whatever that was sold. Now, previously it belonged to the seller and now it belongs to the buyer. Through what process? What was the magical process that resulted in the transfer of ownership? This is what we are talking about, the contract or akad. The akad is that resulted in creating the legal effect and changed the ownership from one person to the other. So this is the process of contract, and the various aspects will become clearer. We are discussing about contract in general. So later you will come across details with regard to specific contracts. Well, now, so remember that in contract to akad in Islamic law, we are not talking of a mere agreement between parties to do things. I will do this, I will do that, or I should do this, I should do that. No. We are talking of the definitive expressions that result in the creation of legal effects there and then. You see? So, if it is a mere agreement to do something, you see, where people undertake to do things or promise to do things, they don't necessarily come under the scope of akad in Islamic law, because in the limited scope of akad, we are referring to those agreements. Well, the word agreement itself is not very proper or suitable, because we are talking of the definitive statements or expressions that create legal effects. This is done, hereby done. You see? It is not something where things are left to be done. The legal effect is created on the spot, and this is what the contract or akad is. So details will come as we go along by and by. I mean the general details. Well, now listen to my previous records and also go through textbooks and get a complete idea, because usually in tests, a question from this area comes, you should have a very clear idea. And if you look at the tutorial questions, can Mr. Mohammed Amzar tell me, where can you find the tutorial questions? Mr. Mohammed Amzar, is he here? Well, class reps, please take note. Let me know of those who are absent.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
You're here? What's your name?
Amzar.
Yes. Yes? Are you Muhammad Amzar?
Yes.
Okay, tell me, where can you find the tutorial questions?
I'm not sure, sir.
Well, they are on the iTali. You see, on the iTali website, I have uploaded the tutorial questions.
The iTali is currently down.
No, not currently. During the iTali. During the class, you need not access, but you should have accessed and go through the documents there, especially the guidelines. So make sure that all of you mean every one of you do this, because this is vital to avoid unpleasant situations and consequences in the future. Well, so if you look at the tutorial questions, which are divided subject wise, you can see the questions from contract. So then you can have a fair idea of how questions come. And you can also detect difficulties in shortcomings in your understanding. And one thing I would advise all of you to do is to read and go through the material and listen to the records if they're available. After this, try explaining things to yourself or to any colleague orally. Try explaining. This is the best way to find out whether you understand something or not. If you run into difficulties in explaining, that means your understanding is not proper there. You see, try explaining. Try to see whether you can explain something properly. For instance, definition of contract. Then you'd be able to see whether you have a clear picture of this or not. Well, a brief comparison with contract in conventional law. Contract in conventional law and the definition of aqd in Sharia or contract in Sharia are parallel, but there are some differences with regard to scope. You can see, I have mentioned the definition we discussed, the Islamic law definition for one of the definitions for contract to aqd, and then one of the definitions for contract in conventional law. You may have come across other definitions, but this is one, which is an agreement to create an obligation binding on the parties involved against a consideration. You can look at each clause of the definitions and then compare. Why are they there? And what purpose do they serve? And if they are not there, or any missing clause, what is the shortcoming created because of that clause being missing? For instance, the crux of the definition in Sharia is conjunction between offer and acceptance. It doesn't say agreement. How does it refer to contract? Conjunction between offer and acceptance, or conjunction between the expressions of the parties. The reference in the conventional definition is more general. It says agreement. Agreement to create an obligation binding on the parties involved. Some definitions mention consideration as well. So agreement to create. First of all, choice of words. Agreement conveys a broader meaning, because agreement can even exist in the mind. People can agree on things. We agree on. One person has the idea, the other person has a similar idea, they agree on that. But it does not mean a contract has come into being, because in Islamic law as well as in conventional law, contract is created at the point of expressing the contractual intent. As long as the intent is confined to the mind, no contract is created in any law. Creation of the contract occurs at the point of expressing the contractual intent. And you will notice that the Islamic law definition makes it quite clear, because it does not refer to mere agreement. It refers to expression of this agreement or expression of contractual intent, and they are coming together, and because that is the point at which the contract is created, contractual obligations and rights are created, legal effects are created. All of that happens at the point of expression and not at the point of agreement, which can even exist before this expression takes place. And you will see that reference to legality is missing in the conventional agreement. So yes, one can argue that it is understood because it refers to binding on the parties. So it becomes binding only when it is legal, but it is not literally mentioned. So in Islamic law definition, this point is literally mentioned and made clear that the aqd refers to only those conjunctions of expressions that take place in legal valid manner, having fulfilled all conditions and taking place for a valid objective and purpose, a recognized purpose. So it is literally referred to here. Well, and you'll see that the Islamic law definition refers to the creation of legal effects. I said only those conjunctions of expressions that resulting in legal effect, they are uqud and they are contracts. Whereas the conventional law definition does not refer to legal effects. Remember, each definition reflects the approach of that law. Because in conventional law, creation of legal effect immediately is not a must. Even things where no legal effect takes place immediately, they can come under contracts. And that's why the term agreement is used in a specific manner, so that those agreements that, even those agreements that do not result in legal effects, they can come under the scope of contract and conventional law. And the fact that this is not referred to specifically here is perhaps to let the definition cover or have a broader scope so as to include those other contracts as well. Well, so you go through the textbooks and find out more ways to compare these two definitions.
I'm sorry, well, sir.
Yes.
Can I ask, the main reference we'll be using is the one by Professor Wahbah Al-Zuhaili. Is that the one?
That's the main one you can refer to, yes. It has almost all the topics we'll be discussing.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay. Well, it doesn't mean you should refer to only that. I have mentioned that you should refer to at least 3 textbooks. If you're referring to, it does not mean reading from cover to cover. It means that you refer to the relevant section as far as the topic, that particular topic is concerned. So you must use at least 3 textbooks in addition to taking notes from the class and referring to the past records if available. Well, now the terms of iltizam and tasarruf. Iltizam is a term which has, well, you can discuss it either in a very detailed manner or brief manner. We'll choose the brief manner. Iltizam refers to the obligations. Obligation created by force of law or through a person binding himself with that obligation. So when you say force of law, we refer to transactions which are legal or contracts that result in obligations, such as the example we give now, which is